So what I will show here is some preliminary results that we have obtained, which are partly the PhD work of Itzia Serrano, and it's also a collaboration with a Japanese colleague Daikichi Ozawa, who is back in Japan at Spring Haven and did some work in looking at cracks in 3D in torsion. So I will just maybe highlight a few differences between torsion and tension compression, as most of you probably know that, but I thought it was important to do it. And a few words about the material, what we know about fatigue crack initiation and propagation into it, that's to say surface observation, and then what's happening in the volcano, some elements of what we think we are going to do in, for analyzing this, and then a few words of some. Okay, so there are many differences, of course, between torsion and tension compression. I think I've highlighted some important ones here. Maximum shear stress is at 0 and 90 degrees and not 45 degrees, and no tensile stress on the slip plates, which makes sometimes crack initiation problematic. Besides, at the surface, the cracks are loaded at mode 2, while it's mode 3 in the bulk. And, to make it worse, the stress level is not constant in the section. If you look at the fracture surface of torsion samples, they are messy. And usually, it's very difficult to understand exactly what's going on in the sample just by looking at the fracture surface. It's quite tricky. So, ideally, you would need some in situ observation, but so far, and that's my point, there has been no 3D in situ observation of the cracks developing inside the sample during torsion. And this is what I will try to show you. The material is a cast aluminium alloy, 7% of silicon, and it's a T6 condition. It's been cast in a permanent mold. So this material has got some porosity, like any other cast aluminium alloy, but in fact, surprisingly, they have no role in torsion. So you can forget about the porosity in torsion. But what does play a role are the grains, and the grain size is relatively large in this type of material, typically also of cast material. It's about half a millimeter. So, what we know about the cracks in 2D is already quite a lot. So, by making a flat surface on the side of the specimen here, you can have a look at the cracks once they initiate and when they propagate at the surface, at least. And what you see usually is a very long, or quite long, transgranular cracks, which look very crystallographic. And for a long, they come across a whole grain, I guess. Okay. Most of them are nearly perpendicular to the sample axis, but you also see some cracks which are parallel to the sample axis, of course. And you can also see some bifurcation at the grain boundaries. So the white lines here are the grain boundaries, and you see some bifurcation. But sometimes you don't even get the bifurcation. This is very white, I don't know why, but there is a grain boundary here. Okay, over here, and you see that the crack is crossing them, the three grains here, without even changing direction. And when you use ESD data, you look at the grain orientation at the surface, and you try to do a little bit of crystal plasticity or tail analysis of that, you can easily show that, the crack planes correspond to 1-1-1 planes, as you would expect, and that they are, for one grain, it works quite well, actually, it's usually the mostly activated grain. So, this is what we know, and sorry, I forgot to say also that reaching the first grain boundary for the surface crack takes approximately one third of the fatigue life. So a lot of the fatigue life will be devoted to propagation of the cracks in the samples. Of course, you would like to know what's happening in the bulk, so there is one way to do it. To do this is to cut the sample, polish, and have a look. And this is what Itzia has been doing. So this is the free surface on the side here. Okay, so the crack rolls towards the interior like this, you see that more or less we keep this crystallographic aspect of the cracks. They still interact a lot with the macrostructure. But of course, there is no chronology. So we would like to know what's happening in real time. And if you want to do this, then you need to do it differently. So we've used X-ray tomography, so I'm not showing tomography anymore. It's, I think, now a well-known technique to follow what's happening in the bulk of an optically opaque material, like a metal. We have used synchrotron X-ray tomography, basically because we have a higher resolution there. We've been working at ESRF in Grenoble on BIM 9 and D19. The voxel size, which is the equivalent of the pixel size for a 2D image, is 2.5 micron. This is not a very small voxel size. I mean, they routinely do 0.5 or 0.7 micron, which would give you a better crack visibility, but this is at the expense of the sample diameter, of course. So here we wanted to have a sample which was 3 millimeter in diameter, so we had to work with this 3 micron voxel size. We've been working with a constant, we keep the angle, the deflection constant throughout the test, and it's a symmetric test with a ratio of minus 1. Okay, so talking about the crack visibility first, we try to assess this by looking at the surface, comparing the surface and reconstructed images. So again, this is the sample here. An SEM image where you see the cracks, 0 degrees crack, sorry, 0 degrees cracks, which are vertical and 90 degrees, and the reconstructed surface of the sample. Looking at both of them, we were quite pleased to see that we had a good crack detection, although this is only at the surface for the moment. So we are fairly confident that we can at least detect quite well the crack, maybe not exactly the crack tip, but at least part of the crack. And of course, from the reconstructed images, you can obtain a rendering, a 3D rendering of the cracks. So, this is what it looks like. So this is the only real 3D image that I will show you. After that, I will only show projections because they are, I think, easier to understand. So the axis of the sample is vertical. We're twisting like this. And you can see that there are two sets of cracks. Some are horizontal or nearly horizontal, like this, this red one and this bluish one, and some are vertical, like this, okay? And they grow towards the interior of the sample. So those cracks here, which are horizontal, I'm going to focus on them, and they correspond, they are really flat when you look at them in 3D, and they do correspond to the crystallographic cracks that I was showing you in 2D at the sample surface. So now we are going to change the point of view. We are looking along the sample axis, okay? And then I will show you the same cracks first, right? Okay, so I kept the same colors. So vertical cracks appear like this, and horizontal cracks are going to be shallow cracks, as I will describe. So we will focus on one, this one. Why not the other one? Well, because there is more work to do. It takes a very long time. And this one is very typical of what we have been seeing for other cracks and other samples. So what's happening on that one? I forgot to say that this is, I need to say something important, is that we did the initiation ex situ. So this is the first image, okay? So we initiate the crack in the lab, and then we went at GSRF to look at the propagation. Why not initiating at ESRF? It's because we didn't have enough beam time. It's hard to get beam time, so we only had one day, so during one day we grew the crack, but we initiated that outside of the beam. So that's why we don't know what was going on before that. That's the first stage, right? Okay, so if we look at this crack, you see that something which is typical and a bit surprising, in fact, is that the cracks are relatively shallow. That they first propagate below the surface and they don't go very deep inside the material. So of course, if you keep cycling, they will eventually grow inside the material. Okay? And to do so, what they do is that they develop some independent branches like this. And when you look at the branches and you compare them with the surface, so for example, you draw some, you reconstruct some slices which are parallel to the sample axis, but they correspond to different planes here along the diameter, along one diameter, what you see is that the cracks are changing direction from something which was nearly perpendicular to the circle axis, and then they rotate until, sorry, this is a bit too wide here, until they rotate and they become 45 degrees, but you say that they tend to open in both. So those, the tracks that I was showing before, those ones, those branches, are more than branch. Okay, so to do it a little bit more quantitative, we've analyzed the crack length, both at the surface here and in the bulk. So C will be the surface crack length, A will be the bulk crack length. And if you plot C and A, well, you get, as expected, a faster increase for C, and then it levels off like this, and then A is a bit smaller. But you see that after a while, they have the same growth rate. And this is the average break strength, which is around here, 500 micron. So, in order to go a bit further, we've tried to analyze this in terms of K values. So, just a very simple and rough model of one of those shallow cracks here. It's an Abacus elastic calculation from which we extract the K values all along the front here, which will be described by a phi angle. And if you plot the K values as a function of the position along the crack tip, well, there is no big surprise. K1 is zero everywhere. K2 is maximum at the surface and then goes down in the bulk. And K3 is maximum in the bulk. So if now you look at K2 and K3, no K1 because it's zero, K2 goes up more rapidly than K3. And for small cracks, you see that K2 is larger than K3. So what we assume is that when we have a shallow crack which initiates in the first ray, then we have a large driving force in mode 2 at the surface that makes the crack grow very rapidly on a very highly activated plane inside one ray, mode 2 crack. And then when you reach those values, you should reach you should be able to activate some mode 3 cracking, but this we don't see. Instead, what we see is that the crack shape changes direction and we move to mode 1 instead. Okay, summary. Well, this is, I think, the first in situ observation of torsion cracks. There had been some observation in the literature, but they were ex situ, was from the Kishiozawa, which is one of the co-authors of the paper. We have seen that the cracks initiate at the surface from highly activated slip planes. That leads to shallow cracks, and that those cracks are growing in a crystallographic mode at the surface. For this material, for this microstructure, we believe that the mode 3 is difficult to activate, but that might be due to some friction. You do see some debris, this was mentioned this morning. And to be able to grow in the bulk, the crack rotate and they grow in mode 1. What we don't know, which is still to be studied, is the influence of the grain boundaries in the bulk, because I saw there was an influence at the surface. In the bulk, the way we are going to do this in the first approach is to use the gate topography plus the infiltration of the material with some liquid gallium, so that you can get the 3D shape of the grain boundaries. And from that, you can understand what's going on below the surface. Of course, this only gives you the shape of the grains and not the orientation, but this is a first approach to try to understand more what's going on. And that's it.